The fifth characteristics of a company is limited liability. This is what I can say as the most attractive characteristics of a company. So if you look at a company, this is most attractive because the liability is limited to the share which you have given. So what is the meaning of limited liability? So if we have a partnership firm, what happens is the partner's liability is unlimited. So even personal assets can be attached. So personal assets can be attached for any of the mistakes of the firm. However, in company, the biggest advantage is the limited liability. So the liability of members' liability is limited. For what is it limited? It is limited to what is your capital contribution. Capital contribution. So example, if you have contributed 5,000 rupees, your liability is maximum only 5,000. Company may have 50 lakhs loss, it is not your liability because of the concept of limited liability. So capital contribution. So members' liability is limited to capital contribution. Next thing we should understand is that suppose there is a company is the liability is maximum to what is subscribed. So what your subscribed shares, that is your maximum liability. So suppose there is shares worth rupees 10,000 you have subscribed, but you have paid only 5,000. Okay, then after that again you will pay 2,000, totally 7,000 you have paid. So maximum your liability now is 3,000 rupees because you have subscribed to shares worth rupees 10,000. And in company, this is the biggest advantage and this is what you can enjoy. But there are some exceptions. That means every time company cannot enjoy limited liability. So when company does not enjoy limited liability, so we call it as exceptions. So this is something which we have to know, the exceptions. So company does not enjoy limited liability when there is false information at the time of incorporation. Incorporation, you give wrong documents. You cannot say liability is limited. It will become unlimited, and that is as per section 7, subsection 7. If the company is intending to fraud the creditors, you cannot enjoy limited liability. So in exam, this can come for 4 marks question. So please know the exceptions to limited liability. Then obviously, if your company is registered as unlimited company, your liability is definitely unlimited. If there is a fraud in the prospectus, so we studied this in detail in prospectus chapter. For example, section 26 matters to be mentioned in prospectus. If you don't mention, then we will be having unlimited liability. So if you want to enjoy limited liability, you should make sure prospectus is proper. Then if the company fails to repay deposit, so this also we study section 73 to 76. So if company is not repaying the deposit which it has taken from the public, they cannot enjoy limited liability. So when a company does not enjoy limited liabilities, these are the 6 points. Last one is if report of the inspector. Under section 224, subsection 5, report of the inspector can be given where he will suggest that the company's liability should be made unlimited because they have created some fraud or any other misrepresentation. So the general rule is, there is limited liability. Members' liability is limited to their capital contribution or to the amount which they promise by way of subscription of shares because you are promising. So only that balance which is not yet paid, it is their maximum liability. But if these 6 cases happen, the liability will become unlimited. Next we go to perpetual succession. So a company never dies except it should be wound up by law. So that means company will have continuous existence. So a company is not like human being will die, but company will not die till we will wind it up. So till we kill the company that is winding up, the company will not die. So winding up is process to close the company. So if we don't do winding up, that means company will be living forever. That means it will have perpetual succession, living forever. And it is an artificial person, not a natural person. We will die, but the company is an artificial person. It will never die. It will have perpetual succession, continuous succession. So directors may die, shareholders may die, still the company will continue to exist. So for example, something like Tata, it started in some 1870 or something, Tata company. People who started Tata are not there now, but the Tata company is still alive because of perpetual succession. You look at any company, any old company, people who started the company will not be there. But then, if you look at partnership firm, the death of partner will be dissolution of firm. So death of partner, even the firm will be dissolved. That is not the case in company. So company will have perpetual succession. So this is the sixth feature of a company. There is a very interesting case relating to perpetual succession relating to World War. So during World War, what will happen? All the members of the company will be doing a meeting, and then suddenly what happens? There is a bomb. So there is a bomb and all of them will get killed. So during the World War, members of one company are doing meeting and everybody dies. So here the decision came that not even a hydrogen bomb can destroy the company. So not even a hydrogen bomb can destroy a company. Why? Because of perpetual succession. So in this example, the meeting is happening, there is a world war, there suddenly there is a big bomb, and then everybody dies. But the company will survive because the company is having perpetual succession. And you can write in the exam, not even a hydrogen bomb can destroy a company. And this is something which is there in a case, and this is something which you should know. So this is to prove that even a hydrogen bomb cannot destroy a company because of the concept of perpetual succession. The seventh feature of a company is separate property. So company can have property in its own name. So in its own name, it can own property. So what kind of property the company can own? Any kind of property, movable or immovable property. So they can enjoy the property, and also they can sell the property, whatever as the case may be. But please remember, when we say property, it can be immovable property like land, building, etc. It can be movable property like vehicles, machinery, or it can also be intellectual property rights like patent. So company can own all of this property, and it can also sell this property. The eighth feature of a company is transferability of shares. So what is transferability of shares? When can company transfer shares? So we understand that company is divided into different parts called as shares. And these shares are what is given to the owners of the company, and owners of the company pay the money, or what we call as capital, to the company. So when we are owning the company, we have the concept of transferability of shares. So one person can transfer the shares to another person, and that is allowed even in private and public company. So what is the advantage for company in share transfer? The company will retain capital. Of course, we do it in detail in share capital chapter, but now let us try to understand. So company will retain capital, and the owners or shareholders have flexibility because they can have it as a liquid asset. They can sell the shares. So that is the advantage for the owners. So for company, they will retain capital. They don't have to not to be repaid. Capital is not repaid to the shareholders. So this is the concept of transferring of the shares. Next we come to the ninth feature of a company, that is capacity to sue and be sued. That is, company is a body corporate, so anybody can file a case against company, and company can also file a case against anyone. So case can be filed against anyone, and anyone can file case against company. That is also there. So anyone can file case against the company. So a company also has some disadvantages, but this is the feature of a company. We are studying the features. What are the different features of a company? Contractual rights. So this is the 10th feature of a company. Company can enter into any contracts, can enter into valid contracts as per Indian Contract Act with anyone, individuals, with different companies, with government, as the case may be. So member cannot sue the company in respect of the contracts that the company has raised. So member cannot say it is not a correct contract because member has passed the resolution. In contract, we should ensure that directors disclose their interest. So suppose they are getting some personal benefit, they should disclose their interest in the contracts which the company is entering into. So that we will study in detail later, but now we should know the company can enter into contracts just like any other normal person. We are studying features of a company. So limitation of action. So here it says that company cannot go beyond some power. So limitation of action is powers. So what is the limits of the powers of the company? Limits of powers of company. So what this says is company cannot go beyond MOA and AOA of the company. So what the company should do is that there are rules and regulations in MOA and AOA, and they have to stick to those rules and regulations. The actions and objects of the company is set by the MOA and AOA. So company should ensure that it will not go beyond what is mentioned in MOA, AOA. We will be studying all this in detail. This is just the basic features of a company. So if you know this much for the time being, it is enough. So what is the company cannot go beyond? We study in MOA. We study the concept of ultra-vires in chapter relating to MOA, AOA. So there are many concepts which we study. So this is the features. Next, we come to separation of management. So company has a separate concept of ownership and management. This is very, very important. Please remember this. So company has two decision making, ownership and management. So management, we call it as board of directors. Ownership, we call it as members or shareholders of the company. And board of directors, we call it as board meeting when they meet. And members, we call it as general meeting. Of course, in general meeting, we have different types like annual general meeting, extraordinary general meeting. We will study that in meetings chapter. But company is having two decision making authority. So company is having two decision making authority, and that is with respect to the ownership and the management. So the separation of ownership and management will give some certain powers to each other. So owners will appoint the management. So appointment of the board of directors is by the owners of the company. So owners will be the persons who will appoint. The owners will not be in the day-to-day functioning. Day-to-day functioning, we will have the directors who will be in the day-to-day functioning. They will conduct the different corporate functions through the company, through the board meeting. So we can say that company is administered and managed by the managerial personnel, that is the board of directors. So that is the meaning of separation of ownership and management. Because if you see in LLP, in proprietorship, in Hindu undivided family, in partnership firm, in all these places, there is only one decision making body. So company, it is one of the most unique features. You can write, this one is one of the very unique features of company, where it is separation of ownership and management. Point 13 is voluntary association for profit. So company is for the profit motive. So company started for profit motive. Of course, there is an exception which we call it as Section 8 company, that is for charitable objects. But a Section 8 company also can make profit, but it is not profit motive. It can make profit, but cannot give dividends. It cannot give dividends. So the general meaning is company is for profit motive and the only objective of company is to make profits. And we should understand that even Section 8 company can make profit, but it cannot give the dividends. So though the objective is not to make profit, the objective is charitable purpose. If they make a profit, it's okay, but they cannot give it back to the shareholders as dividends. Termination of existence. Company does not die naturally. Company has to be wound up. So when we say termination of existence, company can be terminated by winding up the company, and the company has to be finally dissolved by the court order or NCLT order. So this is what we call as the features of a company. This is the 14th feature and the last feature of a company. So this is the entire feature. So please know the features, only then we'll understand company law properly. Development of company law in India. This one, none of the students study. They say it is not going to come for exam, but we should know a little bit of history to understand the Companies Act 2013. In the book, it is given in a very boring format, and that is why no student is reading. And also they say there is no question which will come in exam. But I have made it year-wise, which is easy for you to remember and also very interesting to know what is the history and development of company law in India. So the first year we have to remember is the year 1844. So in the year 1844, the enactment of Joint Stock Companies Act was there in England. So the history is England. So we have joint stock companies which was started in England. So then in the year 1850, the first Companies Act was there in India. So the first Companies Act was started in India in 1850. Then we have the year 1857, where amendment was given for registration with or without limited liability. So there was a major amendment, and this amendment was in connection with registration with or without limited liability. With or without limited liability. So this was happened in 1857. Then the important thing is 1860. So 1860, the same powers, that is registration with or without limited liability, was given to banking and insurance companies. Banking and insurance companies. So the same powers were given to banking and insurance company 1860. So we have to understand the next year, which is 1856. So in 1856, what happened is the act was repealed and the entire provisions became redundant. So act was repealed and all the previous acts have been no more valid. So 1856, we repealed the act. Then the next year, which we have to know, is 1882. So in 1882, after a very long time, we are going to recast the act, the Companies Act. So a new Companies Act came, but finally all this was having a new format where a Consolidating Act was passed in 1913. So Consolidating Act was passed. So if you see, actually it's easy, from 1913, exactly 100 years later, we have Companies Act 2013. That is quite interesting. But that is just for you to remember. So 1913, 2013. So the major first Companies Act, which was consolidating and which was having all the provisions, was 1913. Then in 1936, there was major amendments which we did for the 1913 Act. So there were many amendments for the 1913 Act in the year 1936. So in 1948, what happened is England made a new law. So in England, they had a new Companies Act. So they had a new Companies Act in 1948. So what we did in 1951 is the ordinance was passed in India. The ordinance was the power to intervene in the affairs of the company. So there was an ordinance which was actually very bad. It said that government can intervene in company affairs. So that was what was told in 1951. So finally, in our 1956, we had the Baba Committee, and the Baba Committee, they formulated the Companies Act 1956, which is basically having 658 sections and 15 schedules. So after that, we know very well, cut to 2013. So we had the Companies Act 2013 with 470 sections and 7 schedules, which was for the new corporate India. So this is the brief history. We can study the other parts later, but this is the brief history which you should know, the years, how it developed from 1844 to 1956. The J.J. Irani Committee is the important committee, which was the reason why we had a birth of the new Companies Act 2013. However, we should understand J.J. Irani Committee. There, the government asked for the committee to give a concept paper for company law. So this committee was formed on 2nd December 2004, so very long ago. So J.J. Irani, he was a director in Tata and he was an expert on company law matters. So he was the chairman of the committee. There were many more people in the committee. So this committee was given 6 months' time to do research and come up with a concept paper which is for public comments to advise the government on new company law. So they had to advise the government on new company law. And finally, they came out with the report on the 31st May 2005. So they came with the report, and the report was given to the central government. The central government took the report and they studied, and what the message was given, that there is a new company law for flexible, dynamic and user-friendly regulations. So they wanted to have a company law which is flexible, which is dynamic and which is user-friendly and which is meeting the needs of multinational corporations. Because remember, we had Companies Act 1956, and from 1956 there was no new law. There were many amendments, but that was not a new law. Amendments were there, but then the law was not changing, and there were a lot of problems in the day-to-day affairs for running a company, because the international transactions, MNCs, merger, amalgamation was very fast, but the company law was very slow, and company law did not give permission for many of the activities. So that is the reason why they thought we should have a flexible, dynamic law. So the government approval regime to shareholder approval was the main thing which was suggested in this entire committee. So they said that till this, everything was government approval. Whatever you have to do, even for related party transaction, even for approving contracts, we needed government approval. So we called it as government approval regime. So they told, from government approval, we should give the power to the shareholders, and now it is self-regulation. So shareholders can regulate how their company should run. So shareholders approval regulations or shareholder approval regime. And now in the shareholder approval regime, we have to understand that the penalties are very high. So government is telling you can do what you want, because we are not going to control you. From now on, there is no more government approval. You can have shareholder approval. You can do what you want. But if you do something which is illegal, something which is fraudulent, the penalties will be very high. the punishment will be very high. So yes, we are going to allow you for self-regulation. So self-regulation is something like the Gandhiji concept of Swaraj. So you can self-regulate, but then there will be very huge punishment by the government in Companies Act 2013. So that is the main thing which came about in the J.J. Irani committee report. Going further, we have to understand some things relating to the company's bill. So the company's bill was tabled in the year 2012. So in the year 2012, the company's bill, it had totally 470 sections, which is in 29 chapters, which is having 7 schedules. So finally, what happened is, on the president's assent was received on August 29th, 2013, and finally from 1st April 2014, the act came into effect. So the act came into effect. So this is something which we have to know, and this new Companies Act gave rise to many new concepts. So many new concepts came in the new Companies Act, like dormant company. We will be doing all this, woman director. We will do all this in all the chapters, but I'm giving you idea. Associate company. And mainly it had the new concept of one person company. So many things like this was added in the Companies Act, which finally came from 1st April 2014.